Vishnu IAS Academy, we are coming up with interview training program, a free initiative whereby daily newspaper will be discussed. Everyone, whoever are going for interview, join us. And whoever are not going for interview, the news will be useful for you. Thank you. Hello all. Hope everyone can see me and I am audible. I am visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So we will start today's newspaper, 28th May, and data protection, everything about data protection we will be discussing. MSMEs yesterday we discussed. And today, High Court to hear a plea against media sensationalizing against this individual called as Sushil, Olympian, who is an accused number one in a murder case of the counter wrestler. So in this particular context, I want to ask you, what is the meaning of media sensationalism? Yes, Prithvi, what is media sensationalism?
Sir, it is one where the media gives undue importance to a particular incident which has occurred, and it also interferes with the judicial procedure in one way or the other, like in the perception among the public also. Like it has happened in the Bollywood actor Sushant Singh's suicide, where media has done extensive coverage about CBI's functioning and the major witnesses' activities, etc.
Okay. So what is this case all about, Sushil?
Sir, it is regarding homicide of a young wrestler, where Sushil Kumar is expected to have played a major role, and he was booked under attempt to murder and physical assault and other sections of IPC.
So, I believe with the sports also, there is a need for behavioral change. Drugs issues we are noticing in the sportsmen, various other issues also we will be noticing in sports. So, with the sports, there is a need for any behavioral education or behavioral literacy for Indian sportsmen. What do you believe, Prithvi?
Yes, sir. For any section of the people, there is need for behavioral education. With the great recognition by representing the India in Olympic Games, these sportsmen need to be groomed with respect to their behavior outside the sports arena also. So their activities will have influence over large sections of the people. Many people might get inspired by their actions.
Yes. Yes, Soumit Raju, can you tell me any sports ethics which you recommend? Whether we have any sports ethic, how we have code of conduct for civil servants, whether there is any code of conduct for sportsmen?
Sir, I don't think there is any. I'm not sure, sir. I'm sorry. I don't.
Manoj Kumar?
So I'm not very sure if there is any code of ethics for sports person, sir. But if you would allow me, I would say certain expected behavior from sports person.
Okay, why? Because they are going to become the role models of the society will be learning from them.
And also they represent India on the world stage, sir. Because yes, India's wrestling image has been hit with this incident, sir. So India's yes, reputation is also at stake, sir.
See, Harati, there is a statement, mental health problem could be the next pandemic after COVID. Indian Council of Medical Research told the same, and the WHO also reiterated the same. So what is this mental health problem?
Sir, due to the pandemic, a lot of people's lives have been affected adversely, economically and socially in all other aspects. This is creating a lot of anxiety and other stress-related issues in individuals. this is the mental health that we are talking about. If it is not paid attention at this starting stage, it could develop into something more serious, such as depression, and ultimately leading to self-harm behaviors like suicide, etc. So this should be paid attention at this stage.
In this article, there is something called as Me Too. So if you had gone through this article, you can tell. If not, you can guess. Tell me, what is this Me Too? Sorry, Me Too was there. Me Time. Me Time.
Sir, I have not gone through the article, but I understand what Me Time is. It's about giving attention to its self. It's about self-care. No matter how busy one is in his or her life, you have to take some time to think what is happening, to take care of oneself physically as well as mentally. For instance, 10 minutes of meditation per day, or interacting with family members over dinner, playing with pets, or any other things that can help rejuvenate your mental and physical condition on a daily basis. That is Me Time.
Soumitraj, can you tell me something for Me Time? So what would be the best solutions for this future mental health problems?
Sir, I think for mental health problems, especially it is both for people who are employed as well as not employed and searching for employment. So I think for people who are employed, the organizations can ensure that we can make the organizations set up some mental health committees mandatorily. And also for the unemployed people, sir, I think state must proactively create district-wise mental health committees. And also, sir, I think it is a taboo today that someone is not able to speak about their mental health outside. So I think we need to bring out celebrities and encourage celebrities like Deepika Padukone, who has often spoken about mental health issues and challenge the taboo of mental health.
Kiran Kumar, so you people are speaking about mental health. So in this competitive world, you are writing a competitive examination and you are attending the UPSC interview. Is it not the competition affect the mental health?
Sir, yes, sir. Competition is one such thing that is playing the role in affecting mental health. But also the social pressure associated with the competition also plays some role, sir. And during this pandemic, many of the people were isolated. They weren't coming out of their homes. So interaction is also very less, sir. And also in the penetration of digital, many people are more attached to computer and digital, and they are not involved in physical activities, sir. That is also playing some role in affecting mental condition, sir. They are not interacting with people, which is essential for good mental health.
I am telling that the competitive examinations are also one of the reasons for mental health. What do you say? Is it not the child who is pressurized for the competition? Is it not you pressurized for the competition to get the better rank?
Yes, sir. Competition also is playing a major role. But the other factors which I have mentioned are playing more.
So how to overcome the competition, Prithvina? How our attitude should be there? Why? Because competition is inevitable in 21st century.
Sir, the stress associated with competition, which is reinforced by the societal pressure, is the major reason why mental health issues occur among students and lead to suicides. One way we can tackle this is to remove this social pressure, where a broader outlook has to be developed that examinations are not the deciding factor. Healthy competition should be encouraged, and students should be made aware that it is not the end of the life. They have more opportunities to explore. And also, commercialization of education is one which is adding to this menace. For example, the rising number of coaching institutes which are rank oriented, which pressurize the students, and also the parents' aspirations for early settlement of the students and get them into elite institutions. So overall, there should be awareness generation among population to change the parents' attitude towards education and children's approach towards these competitive examinations.
Nagababu, what is your say if you are a district collector? What steps you will be taking in your district in order to ensure mental health?
Sir, first is awareness about mental health, that people should realize that it is not a disease. It is like normal physical injury which can be cured. This can also be cured. The stigma associated with mental health must be removed. First, those awareness campaigns will be my priority, sir. After that, if some people need help, there must be a counseling team which can be available to people who need these services. And also, maybe we can launch a teleconsultations where people can directly contact through WhatsApp or normal phone call, where can they get help. Maybe these three things can help, sir.
Yes, very good. See, what is this, Somit? Central Vista Redevelopment Project.
It is an infrastructure project of Government of India, where it is trying to revamp the whole Raisina Hill and which is the area which is called UT and Delhi in common parlance, sir. So they want to revamp that, and they are trying to build a new parliament and along with many other central government institutions, buildings there, sir. So, and how it is also in controversy now, because many people who criticize the project say that they are of the opinion that we do not need such a massive spending amidst such a pandemic, sir.
What is your say?
I think we need to decouple these two issues, sir, because it is not just that we are spending 20,000 crore in a year, we are spending it over 5 years for the Central Vista project, and infrastructure activity itself generates a lot of employment, and it pushes a lot of money into the economy, which revives us from the COVID situation, which would help us revive from the COVID situation, sir. So
it's necessary. Okay, this article is about Central Vista Redevelopment Project. The next is about hate speech. Yes, I want to ask you, Harati, tell me the difference between hate speech, when does the sedition will be applied? When does the sedition will be applied, section 124A of the IPC and section 66A of Information Technology Act 2000, which is struck down by the Supreme Court. So can you tell me what is the difference between these three?
Yes, sir. Hate speech is defined as speech that targets, discriminates, and incites violence towards an individual or a group on the basis of their identity, such as gender or religion or caste, etc. So this is hate speech. The main criteria is it has to incite violence on the basis of identity of that person. Now, sedition is a speech which incites hatred towards an elected government. So the criteria here is that your speech is targeted towards the government. An elected government. And
the government or to topple the government?
So it's to topple or spread hatred towards the elected government, rightfully elected government. And the third, we invoke section 66 of the IT Act when offensive speech or disturbing speech is being circulated or transmitted through the electronic media. So this deals specifically with the messages being circulated in the electronic media, not otherwise.
Kiran Kumar, difference between the three?
Sir, as Uma mentioned, hate speech is that when a speech is targeted towards certain community to incite violence against them or to create hatred against that group. That group can be caste based on caste, religion, or gender, or anything. Second, the sedition is when you incite hatred, not the hatred. It is to topple the government that is in power, elected government. Then
it is to topple the government or to criticize the government.
It is not to criticize the government, sir. As the Supreme Court has mentioned in I think Kedarnath case. It is only when it is to topple the government, this Sedition Act is used. And recently it was used against MP in Andhra Pradesh. Thirdly, it is about IT Act. So Section 66 of IT Act, when only on electronic media, when some speech or when some content is circulated, which is disturbing or which is... inciting violence or creating hatred towards certain group, then it is under Section 66. It was struck down by Supreme Court because it creates chilling effect on freedom of speech on internet mediums.
Yes. Factual question. Which judgment is that struck down of Section 66A of IT Act? Shreya Singhal. Yes, very good. So, Kiran, you were been telling something about your MP case. What is that MP case?
Yes, sir. MP Raghuram Raju, he was criticizing Andhra Pradesh chief minister for the acts done by him. So he was creating, the accusation on him was, he was creating hatred towards the government in an effort to topple the government of Andhra Pradesh formed by YSRCP. That was the...
MP is a ruling party MP or opposition party MP?
He was in the same party which he was criticizing.
Okay, he was a ruling party MP.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what he was criticizing? What was the issue about?
Sir, it was an issue about he was trying to portray the present chief minister against some religion. He was trying to create hatred towards that CM from a major religion.
So is it a genuine case or it's a political issue?
According to me, there is some political basis to that case, sir. But it is to courts to decide.
What the Supreme Court gave the judgment?
Supreme Court has granted a bail to him, sir. The investigation is further going on.
Yes. Yes. So there is something called as, yes, that we discussed, as Hate Speech Information Technology Act. This is about cyclone, storms, two-state solution. Yesterday we discussed about one-state solution. Today it is about two-state solution. Supreme Court had cautioned government on privacy, dehyphenation, right to privacy, mainly with respect to WhatsApp. This is BRICS summit, which is going to start June 1. After June 1st, we will be coming to the conclusion. So there we can discuss about the outcomes of this ministerial meeting of BRICS. Biden ordered probe into the virus, whether the virus is being created in the laboratory or it's naturally made. Biden has been ordered for a probe. Gaza attack may constitute war crimes. Yes. Yes, tell me, Soumit Raju, what is the meaning of war crimes?
The world through its phases through multiple wars has learned that in order to keep the wars to the nations and a national issue and not to harm the innocent civilians, they came up with a few rules, sir. And these rules are meant to not hurt the civilians and to have a structured war, even if it is a fight, even if it is a conflict. And in this case, sir, because Israel and Gaza...
What is war crimes?
Sir, I'm sorry, sir. That is what I know.
Yes.
Perhaps I think if it is against the Geneva Convention and there is mass murdering or a targeted a persecution against a community, through a war, through violence.
Yes. What, Prithvinath, what is war crimes?
Sir, these are actions of violence which go against the established conventions with regard to wars, like Geneva Convention, I believe, sir. For example, attacking civilians, indiscriminate use of weapons, etc.
Are the war crimes?
Yes, so these are when an act goes against the laws of war, and it is a war crime. For example, torturing prisoners of war, taking civilians as hostages, or targeting civilian property or cultural property on the other side. These are all not accepted under the international law. So if you violate, that's a war crime.
Can you tell me a few examples of war crimes?
No, sir, I'm unable to recollect it.
Kiran Kumar, Manoj Kumar?
Sir, using human shield during the war, or attacking the civilians, beheading and using that head to show to the others, challenging the others, and using chemical weapons to, and using torture, rape of women from the other side. All these are considered war crime under the international convention, sir.
Few examples, Manoj Kumar?
Sure.
I think ISIS attacking site of Palmyra in Syria is one of those war crimes, sir. And second one, I can, so that's all I can
say. Sir, if we look at history, I think Japan, when it attacked Manchuria, and the Japanese soldiers brutally have committed crimes against the Chinese people there, sir. Yes. And also, perhaps we can also take the example of Germany during World War II.
Against Jewish.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So I against think Armenia. There were certain claims regarding Indian intervention in Sri Lanka too, sir. During war, there was claims that war, women were affected with that. There was war.
So in order to control these war crimes, two courts are there. So can you tell me the functions of International Criminal Court, International Court of Justice? What is the difference between ICC and ICJ? Anyone voluntary?
Sir, ICJ is a wing of the United Nations. It generally deals with a wide variety of disputes that occur between states. ICC is a court particularly to deal with big crimes, like large crimes such as genocides and etc. Yes, war crimes against individuals. Like states do not go to trial there, it's the individual. The idea is because sometimes individuals may escape the domestic judicial system or the laws. So we are trying to ensure the trial occurs outside in a impartial manner.
Very good. Very good. Yes. It's about Twitter, about the same. Gaza. Yes. So data protection we will go for. Yes. What is big data, Manoj Kumar?
So big data is a data which has few characteristics, like it is huge in volume, sir. It has veracity. And it needs velocity to process it, sir. In simple words, big data is huge amount of data that needs newer technologies to process them, sir.
Okay, very good.
It involves data mining and some other technologies.
Kiran, just to tell me, this data means what?
So data is any statistic or any information related to some other aspects, like data of COVID patients, data of...
Yes, correct. Go on.
Yeah, like data of COVID patients, information about where the cases are, if it is linked to GPS with the Arogya Setu app, whether the information about all the citizens who are beneficiaries of insurance scheme like PM Jai. Yes, sir.
So who are possessing this mass data? Like corporates?
Yes, sir. Presently, major corporates are having most of the major data, sir. Facebook.
Example, like Amazon, Flipkart, Byju's, Unacademy. These all are having the very targeted data. So if this data will come out, it will be like in a business.
Yes, sir.
There is something called as Cambridge Analytica scandal. Are you aware of this, Harati?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Sir, it was a data breach that occurred from the side of the Facebook social media platform. So the data of the individuals was taken and analyzed by a political campaign firm called Cambridge Analytica. And this data, through the data, it was able to send very targeted campaign messages to the individuals and thereby influencing their voting decision.
Do you know, with respect to our what we are seeing in the YouTube, what we are seeing in the Facebook, the same thing will be coming on our window if you notice. That is called as the mix of data plus artificial intelligence. So if our data goes outside, the targeted company or the targeted firm can send the messages, can send us to see that frequently so that we will be attracted towards it. So in this way, the data manipulation can happen. Yes, in this context, I will ask you, what is a new data protection bill 2019? Prithvi, tell me the provisions of this.
So the new data protection bill talks about storage of the data within the country and requirement of consent for the processing of personal data and appointment of officers who can look after where the data is being processed and who can resolve the grievances of the social media platform users. Sir, these are few provisions I can remember.
Yes. Soumitraj, very clearly to the point, I want the provisions of data protection bill.
The data protection law talks about entities, sir. Those are data principal and data fiduciary. Data principal being the person whose data is being used, and data fiduciary being the person who is using the data. And it also defines what is critical data and sensitive data. It has also given exceptions for some of the government institutions to avail of the to liberalize the data privacy regulations, and these institutions can get data in terms of national security aspects.
Utkarsh, Data Protection Bill 2019 provisions.
Sir, as Soumit has mentioned, Data Protection Bill majorly aims to regulate how the data is being used and processed by different companies for storing the data. It aims to define different terms, that is data fiduciary or data principal. It further aims to enforce different rights, such as right to be forgotten or right of the manner in which the data will be used, right of consent of the particular person whose data will be taken up by the companies.
See, earlier the data protection was been there under IT Act 2000, but the data protection is only for the private. The private should not give the data to the outsiders. Now in this bill, the first is applicable to all, government as well as private. Everyone is under the ambit of the Data Protection Act, by which the data should not come out without the consent of the individual, number one. Number two, the government can exempt some agencies by using the data without the consent of the individuals. It will tell that with the consent of the individuals only they can take the data, but the government itself tells that some agencies can be exempted by the central government without the consent of the individual. The data can be used for any research or anything, for any purpose, number two. And number three is there will be a data protection authority. This data protection authority will be looking into this particular data related, the storage, the grievances, everything will be looking after by this data protection authority, an independent effective regulator. These are the major three points. Apart from that, the data should be stored in India only. With the permission, the data can be processed out of the country. So three types of data are being categorized: general, sensitive, critical. Under this particular, in any case, the sensitive and critical should not go out of the country. In any case, sensitive and critical, only general data can go out of the country with the consent of the individual. In the same context, there is one more act which is called as Disha Act. Can anyone tell me what is this Disha Act? Digital Information Security in Healthcare Act. Harati?
Sorry, sir, I'm not aware of this legislation.
Anyone? Digital Information Security in Healthcare Act. Digitalization of my health related information should not come out. So now all the health related information will be digitalized and it will be forming the data, and that data should not be removed out. It seeks to ensure protection of data related to physical, physiological, mental health, sexual orientation and medical records of the individuals in a data form. Yes, they can form in the data, but that data should not be revealed out. The protection of the health related things also should be saved according to this data. Disha Act 2008. So, why this is not getting legislation, whether it is going to get the legislation, means what are the criticism, what are the concerns for this bill, Prithvinath? Utkarsh.
Sir, I think the difficulty in exactly defining what is personal and non-personal data is one criticism. And exemptions being provided to government agencies, and it is against the right to privacy, the right to freedom of speech and expression of the individuals in some aspects.
Utkarsh, what are the criticism for this act, for this bill?
Sir, I'm not much aware about it.
Yes. Anyone can tell me about the criticism of this bill? This is mains wala question.
Sir, sir, I believe the legislation also calls for data localization.
Yes, data localization. What is that?
This, sir, it says that data created by the Indian citizens has to be stored within the country. Even if you're processing outside the country, you can only take a copy there. But the original should stay within the country. So this has been objected by the digital media companies because their model, economic model, rests on harvesting the data of data created in the country, and all the the infrastructure that you need to actually analyze this data is located outside the country. So they want the data to be carried outside for processing. So this has been a major friction point between the government and those who call for more liberalized data. Even countries like Japan and Europe have suggested that we keep the data flow more liberal as to not call for localization, etc. I believe this is one of the reasons that delaying the legislation.
Okay. So can you tell me any the best practices across the world for data protection so that we can implement the same in India? There are best practices like
in the world. There are two places, sir, where the data protection is of the highest standards. One is in Europe, which is GDPR, and also the other one is in California, sir, which is also ensuring that the most private data of the citizens in these two regions are not compromised by the big companies.
GDPR means what?
Sir, if I'm able to recollect, it is General Data Protection Regulation.
Yes, yes. How it works?
Sir, it ensures that their consent is properly taken by the big tech companies of the whenever they are seeking data from the citizens of Europe, sir. For example, an e-commerce company need to explicitly mention what data is being used, and also they also have a provision of data localization, sir, where their original data must be stored in Europe.
Okay.
So this is what I'm able to recollect.
See, data protection is very important this time. So in this content, I provided you with the European Union best practices. USA is also best practice, but the European Union is the best practice. Why? Because stronger proof of consent, right to data portability, allows individuals to obtain and reuse their personal data across different services according to the individual's wish. Right to erase also, the data can be erased. For example, at one point of time, I added my health data, my health related information. So there will be a data bank, data thing for individual person, like a number will be given to the individual. So in that particular, I can remove my health related information. So data erase option is also there in European Union. International implications, data collectors can be held responsible for violation with a third party user. So mainly, these are the few points where if we want for data protection, the European Union clauses are more successful in data protection when compared to any part of the world.
So recent IT rules to have brought out these ideas, like having data protection officer resident in India, and the international companies following the same rules as the national companies would follow, or also inspired by through GDPR rules.
Yes.
Sir, does our data protection bill have a provision of right to be forgotten?
No. Erasure, no. That is a criticism, which is there in GDPR. Yes. Yes, my question, another factual question. The data protection bill was then formed based on the recommendation of which committee?
It should be BNC Krishna Committee, sir.
Yes, BNC Krishna Committee. There are some recommendations given by this individual. Technology agnostic law. Flexible means, according to the changing technologies, the data which is shared should be changed so that the data breach will not happen. So there are some recommendations given by BNC Krishna Committee to both private sector and the government. Earlier, IT Act only for the private sector. Now, bill is private and government sector on the recommendations of BNC Krishna Committee. Informed and meaningful consent of the individuals about their data. They have to be concerned when they are using minimal and necessary data processing. The data processing should be happening minimal. All the data should not be necessarily taken according to BNC Krishna. These all points are being taken in the data protection bill. Data controller must be accountable for any processing. Establishing a high-powered statutory authority for enforcement supported by decentralized enforcement mechanism, data protection authority. Penalties for wrongful data processing. Recently, which all big private companies were being in news for data theft? Can you name some of them? Where the data came out? Leaked.
Sir, very, very recently in India, Domino's had a data leak, sir.
Yes, Domino's, very good.
Zomato too had a data leak,
sir. Big wigs.
SBI also had a data leak, sir. 32 lakh debit card data was leaked in 2018.
Yes. An academy also. So this is a common problem, day on day. It's a very common problem. This McDonald's yesterday or day before yesterday, it happened, no? So this data leaking is happening in a very frequent way. So more command on the subject is necessary for the data protection. Yes. So tomorrow we will meet on tomorrow's newspaper, as well as please tell me which topic we will do tomorrow. Refinance, Prithvi?
Sir, refinance is, I can try to explain with an example.
Yes.
Like if I am borrowing a loan from Bank A.
You are borrowing from SBI.
Yeah, from SBI at some interest rate. So there will be another agency like Mudra, which will refinance this loan at a lower interest rate or higher installments, like easing the borrowing for me, reducing the borrowing cost for me.
So that means you are getting from SBI or from Mudra?
I'm getting from SBI, which is being refinanced by Mudra.
Okay. That means the SBI is getting from Mudra.
Yes, sir.
So when you pay back to the SBI, that means it is going to the Mudra.
Yes, sir. And if I am not able to pay the regular mechanisms which will affect my credit history, etc., will apply, and regular procedures to initiate my insolvency will apply, I think.
Okay. If you are not paying to the SBI, then who will be the loser, whether it be the SBI or the Mudra?
It will be Mudra, sir.
Okay. So, this commercial banks will be in safer side.
Yes, sir.
Very good. So, tomorrow, with tomorrow's newspaper, we will discuss about investments, different varieties of investments, how the investments in 2021 because of COVID. Current status of investments we will be discussing. I will be sending the PDF into the group. Thank you.